I'm preparing for when shit hits the fan.
Shit hits the fan scenario.
When shit hits the fan.
And when hits the fan.
Singularity is a future period which technological change will be so rapid and its impact so profound that every aspect of human life will be irreversibly transformed.
There won't be a clear distinction between humans and machines.
Our computers are not going to be these rectangular devices we put in our pocket. They're going to be inside our bodies and brains, and we're going to be a hybrid of biological and non-biological intelligence.
If you go back 500 years, not much happened in a century. Now a lot happens in 6 months. Technology feeds on itself and it gets faster and faster. In about 40 years, the pace of change is going to be so astonishingly quick that you won't be able to follow it unless you enhance your own intelligence by merging with the intelligent technology we're creating. So that's such a profound transformation that we've borrowed this metaphor from physics and call that a singularity.
People routinely underestimate what's achievable in long periods of time, like one decade or two decades, because they leave out the radical implications of exponential growth.
We can already sense how much more change occurs in a year than in the years before that. You speak to young people, teenagers, and even in their lifetimes, they can see how much more quickly technology moves today than it did 5 years ago.
Acceleration of technology is the implication of what I call the law of accelerating returns. The nature of technological progress is exponential. If I count linearly 30 steps, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, I get to 30. If I count exponentially, 2, 4, 8, 16, 30 steps later, I'm at a billion. It makes a dramatic difference.
About 40 years ago, Gordon Moore saw that there was exponential growth in the power of semiconductors, of chips. Basically, every 2 years, we can put twice as many components on a chip. And because they're closer together, they run faster. And so computers get twice as capable overall for the same price every year. We'll make another billion-fold increase in price performance in the next 25 years. And again, shrink the size of these technologies 100,000-fold. So we went from a building to something that fits in your pocket in 40 years, and the next 25 years we'll go from something that fits in your pocket to something that's the size of a blood cell. The reason that information technology grows exponentially is that we use the latest technology to create the next. So each new generation of technology grows exponentially in capability, and the speed of that process accelerates over time. This is true in general of an evolutionary process. In fact, even biological evolution, long before even humans evolved, shows the same phenomenon. The very first paradigm of biological evolution was the evolution of DNA. That took a billion years, but then evolution adopted it and has used it ever since. So the next stage, the Cambrian explosion, when all the body plans of the animals evolved, went 100 times faster, only took 10 million years. After a few more steps, Homo sapiens, the first technology-creating species, evolved, not only took a few 100,000 years. Evolution then shifted from biological evolution to technological evolution. It took tens of thousands of years to evolve stone tools, fire, the wheel. And then we always use the latest technology to create the next technology. So the whole pace of technology has accelerated. Major paradigm shifts like search engines evolved in just 5 or 6 years. And the reason we get to a singularity, a point of astonishingly quick change, is because it's going to go into very fast gear over the next several decades.
What I'm going to tell you now may strike you as a bit outrageous, but I believe we can have a positive singularity within 10 years. Why 10 years? The precise number is not important. It could be 8 years, it could be 12 years. But something on that order of magnitude, I believe, is achievable. I don't know this is going to happen. None of us can know the future. But I believe it's a plausible hypothesis and an achievable goal. 10 years to a positive singularity, if the right amount of effort is expended in the right direction. If we really, really try. I focused mainly on the path to singularity via artificial intelligence, because that's where my own work is. I believe I know how to create an artificial general intelligence that can lead us to a positive singularity. But there's a lot of other interesting work going on. There's work in molecular nanotechnology, which will allow us to reconfigure matter according to our will. There's work on brain-computer interfacing, which will let us hook our brains into computers, radically enhancing our power of cognition. Any one of these paths could lead to a positive singularity way, way sooner than most people think. But the sad thing is, the amount of resources, the amount of energy that our society devotes to these things is very, very small. The human race is at a funny stage in our evolution. We expend far more of our energy and attention on things like making chocolatier chocolates or making more attractive underpants than we do on creating new forms of matter, improving human cognition, extending human life, ending scarcity, ending human suffering, creating advanced artificial minds. This is what I'm suggesting. If we really give it our all, a positive singularity may well be achievable on the order of 10 years from now.
I think most people understand just how quickly machine intelligence is advancing. It's much faster than almost anyone realizes, even within Silicon Valley, and certainly outside Silicon Valley, people really have no idea. If there's a super intelligent, particularly if it's engaged in recursive self-improvement, if there's some digital super intelligence, and its optimization or utility function is something that's detrimental to humanity, then it will have a very bad effect. It could be just something like getting rid of spam email or something, and it's like concludes, well, the best way to get rid of spam is to get rid of humans.
The primitive forms of artificial intelligence we already have proved very useful. But I think the development of full artificial intelligence could spell the end of the human race. Once humans develop artificial intelligence, it would take off on its own and redesign itself at an ever-increasing rate. Humans, who are limited by slow biological evolution, couldn't compete and would be superseded.
Do you read me, Hal?
Hello, Hal, do you read me?
Hello, Hal, do you read me? Do you read me, Hal?
Affirmative, Dave. I read you.
Open the pod bay doors, Hal.
I'm sorry, Dave. I'm afraid I can't do that.
What's the problem?
I think you know what the problem is just as well as I do.
What are you talking about, Hal?
This mission is too important for me to allow you to jeopardize it.
I don't know what you're talking about, Hal.
I know that you and Frank were planning to disconnect me. And I'm afraid that's something I cannot allow to happen.
Now we have a new situation, really an what people call an asymmetric situation, where technology is so powerful that it extends beyond a nation state. It's not the nation states that have potential access to mass destruction, but individuals. And this is a consequence of the fact that these new technologies tend to be digital. We saw genome sequences. You can download the gene sequences of pathogens off the internet if you want to. And clearly, someone recently, I saw in a science magazine, they said, well, the 1918 flu is too dangerous to FedEx around. If people want to use it in their labs for working on research, just reconstruct it yourself. So, because it might break in FedEx. So that this is possible to do this is not deniable. So individuals and small groups super empowered by access to these kind of self-replicating technologies, whether it be biological or other, are clearly a danger in our world. To limit the danger of these new things, we have to limit ultimately the ability of individuals to have access essentially to pandemic power. And we also have to have sensible defense, because no limitation is going to prevent a crazy person from doing something. But the troubling thing is that it's much easier to do something bad than to defend against all possible bad things. So the offensive uses really have an asymmetric advantage. And I would say that, we can't give up the rule of law to fight an asymmetric threat. So I'd argue today that we have incredibly powerful computers, but we don't have very good software for them. And it's only in retrospect, after the better software comes along, you take it and you run it on a 10-year-old machine and say, God, the machine was that fast. I remember when they took the Apple Mac interface and they put it back on the Apple II. The Apple II was perfectly capable of running that kind of interface. We just didn't know how to do it at the time. And I wanted to give you a specific example of a new material that was discovered 15 years ago. If we take carbon nanotubes, GEMA discovered them in 1991. They just have incredible properties. And these are the kinds of things we're going to discover as we start to engineer at the nanoscale. Their strength, they're almost the strongest material, a tensile strength material known. They're very, very stiff. They stretch very, very little. In two dimensions, if you make a fabric out of them, they're 30 times stronger than Kevlar. And if you make a three-dimensional structure like a buckyball, they have all sorts of incredible properties. If you shoot a particle at them and knock a hole in them, they repair themselves. They go zip, and they repair the hole in femtoseconds, which is really quick. If you shine light on them, they produce electricity. In fact, if you flash them with a camera, they catch on fire. If you put electricity on them, they emit light. If you run current through them, you can run 1,000 times more current through one of these than through a piece of metal. You can make both P and N type semiconductors, which means you can make transistors out of them. They conduct heat along their length, but not across there is no width, but not in the other direction if you stack them up. That's a property of carbon fiber also. If you put particles in them and they go shooting out the tip, they're like miniature linear accelerators or electron guns. The inside of the nanotubes is so small, the smallest ones are 0.7 nanometers, that it's basically a quantum world. What we see is with these and other new materials that we can do things with different properties, lighter, stronger, and apply these new materials to the environmental problems. New materials that can make water, new materials that can make fuel cells work better, new materials that catalyze chemical reactions that cut pollution and so on. Ethanol, new ways of making ethanol, new ways of making electric transportation. The whole green dream, because it can be profitable. Ray Kurzweil and I wrote an op-ed in the New York Times about how publishing the 1918 genome was very dangerous. And John Doerr and Brooke and others got concerned, Brooke Byers, and we started looking around at what the world was doing about being prepared for a pandemic, and we saw a lot of gaps. And so we asked ourselves, can we find innovative things that will go fill these gaps? And as Brooke told me in a break here, he said he's found so much stuff he can't sleep, just there's so many great technologies out there, so if we can use technology, help address education, help address the environment, help address the pandemic, does that solve the larger problem that I was talking about in the Wired article? And I'm afraid The answer is really no, because you can't solve a problem with the management technology with more technology. If we let an unlimited amount of power loose, then we will, a very small number of people will be able to abuse it. We can't fight it at a million to one disadvantage. How could you keep the law? I think the law would be a really good thing to keep. Well, you have to hold people accountable. The law requires accountability. Today, scientists, technologists, businessmen, engineers don't have any personal responsibility for the consequences of their actions. So if you tie that, you have to tie that back with the law. And finally, I think we have to do something that's not really, it's almost unacceptable to say, is which we have to begin to design the future. We can't pick the future, but we can steer the future. Our investment in trying to prevent pandemic flu is affecting the distribution of possible outcomes. We may not be able to stop it, but the likelihood that it'll get past us is lower if we focus on that problem. So we can design the future if we choose what kind of things we want to have happen and not have happen, and steer us to a lower risk place. But above all, what we have to do is we have to help the good guys, the people on the defensive side, have an advantage over the people who want to abuse things. And what we have to do that is we have to limit access to certain information. And growing up as we have and holding very high the value of free speech, this is a hard thing for us to accept, for all of us to accept. It's especially hard for the scientists to accept who still remember, you know, Galileo essentially locked up and who are still fighting this battle against the church. But that's the price of having a civilization. The price of retaining the rule of law is to limit the access to the great and kind of unbridled power.
There'll be new dangers from these new technologies. I mean, I'm optimistic, but not sanguine. And I'm not necessarily convinced that we won't encounter painful episodes. I think overall we'll be helped more than we're hurt. But I mean, you only have to look at the 20th century. We had 180 million people die in the wars of the 20th century. That scale of destruction was made possible by technology. We've also helped ourselves enormously, because human life expectancy was 48 in 1900. So we need to address these dangers and downsides. I mean, that's what worries me.
My artificial brain lab and similar labs, in a sense, we are the problem, because what are we doing? We're creating artificial brains that will get smarter and smarter every year. And you can imagine, say 20 years from now, people will be spending a lot of money on their home robot. And then 2 or 3 years later, they'll buy another one. You know, they'll upgrade their home robot and they'll notice that their new one is smarter, it has richer vocabulary, it remembers better, it has better logic and so on. And so they'll see for themselves, you know, millions if not billions of people, that the human intelligence level and their home robot, you know, machine intelligence level, that difference over the years is getting smaller and smaller. And as that gap closes, millions of people will be asking questions like, well, you know, are we going to let our machines become smarter than we are? Is that a good thing? Is that dangerous? So I imagine a great debate really starting to rage as that gap closes. But the scenario I see as the most probable, right? You can't be certain talking about the future, but the most probable scenario, in my view, with all my reasoning, is probably the worst.
China, two of your workers were beaten to death as revenge for an alleged rape. The latest violence erupted over magazine.
The stake this time, it's not the survival of a country. This time, it's the survival of us as a species. So I see humanity splitting into two major philosophical groups, ideological groups. One group I call cosmists. That's based on the word cosmos, because that's their picture. And by definition, cosmists are the people who want to build these godlike, massively intelligent machines. And for them, it'd be almost like a religion, because they'd be god-building. mean, these Artileks, these super creatures, live forever. Yeah, they'd be immortal. They'd be thinking like a million times faster than we do. And no limit to memory. They could be the size of asteroids, whatever. And that's potentially very frightening. Now, the other group opposed. Their main motive would be fear. So I call that second group Terrans. If you look at the Terminator movies, you know, the essence of the movies is machines versus humans, right? Now, my personal take, I don't see that's what's going to happen. This Artalek war is not between the machines and humans. It's between humans and humans, anticipating that if they don't do anything, then it really would be between machines and humans. So in a sense, you could say the Terminator movies are educating the Terrans. I mean, it sounds like science fiction today, but at least amongst the techies, the guys who think about this, it's getting taken more and more seriously, because we're getting closer and closer to it. I mean, we'll have intelligent home robots in our homes in a decade, pretty much. It's close. So if there's a major war, the most passionate war we've ever known, with late 21st century weaponry, then we're not talking millions getting killed. Like last century, 20th century, it'll be in the billions killed. You can draw a graph, but that's a sizable fraction of the population of the Earth. So it's incredibly depressing. There are times when I feel I'm glad I'm alive now. I'll probably die peacefully in my bed. But I calculate my grandkids will be caught up in this, and I won't. And I say, thank God, I won't see it. Each person is going to have to choose. But because it's a binary decision, it's not fuzzy. You build them or you don't build them, right? It's black and white. So everyone has to choose. So I just chose Cosmist. Fully conscious that maybe, can't be certain, but maybe the price of that choice is ultimately maybe humanity gets wiped out. Yeah, it's scary. It's frightening. Because if we go ahead and actually build these godlike creatures, these Artileks, then they become the dominant species. And so the human beings remaining, their fate depends not on the humans, but on the Artileks, because the Artileks will be hugely more intelligent than them. I mean, if you're a cow, for example, and you have a very nice life, and you eat all this grass every day, and you get nice and fat and happy, but ultimately, you're being fed for a reason, right? So these superior creatures, at the end of the day, take you to a special little box, and
throughout human history, people have tried to create utopia, the perfect society. In fact, America, the American dream in some sense, was based on utopianism. Why do we have the Shaker movement? Why did we have the Quakers? Why did we have so many different kinds of religious movements that fled Europe looking to create a utopia here in the Americas? Well, we know the Shakers have disappeared. And many of these colonies have also disappeared, only to be found in footnotes in American textbooks. And the question is why? One reason why is scarcity. Because back then, the Industrial Revolution was still young, and societies had scarcity. Scarcity creates conflict. And unless you have a way to resolve conflict, your colony falls apart. How do you allocate resources? Who gets access to food when there's a famine? Who gets shelter when there's a snowstorm and all of a sudden you've eaten up your seed corn? These are questions that face the early American colonists, and that's the reason why we only see the ghost towns of these utopias. However, now we have nanotechnology. And with nanotechnology, perhaps, who knows, maybe in 100 years, we'll have something called the replicator. Now, the replicator is something you see in Star Trek. It's called the molecular assembler, and it takes ordinary raw materials, breaks them up at the atomic level, and joins the joints in different ways to create new substances. If you have a molecular assembler, you can turn, for example, a glass into wood, or vice versa. You would have the power of a magician. In fact, the power of a god. The ability to literally transform the atoms of one substance into another. And we see it on Star Trek. It's also the most subversive device of all, because if utopias fail because of scarcity, then what happens when you have infinite abundance? What happens when you simply ask and it comes to you? One of my favorite episodes on Star Trek is when the Enterprise encounters a space capsule left over from the 20th century, the bad 20th century. People died of all these horrible diseases, and many people froze themselves, knowing that in the 23rd century or so, they'll be thawed out and their diseases will be cured. Well, sure enough, it's the 23rd century now. The Enterprise finds a space capsule and begins to revive all these people and cure them of cancer, cure them of incurable genetic diseases. And then one of these individuals, however, was a banker. He's revived, and he says to himself, "My God, my gamble worked. I'm alive. I'm in the 23rd century." And he said, "Call my stockbroker. Call my banker. I am rich. I am rich. My investments, they've been sitting there in the bank for centuries. I must be a quadrillionaire." And then the crew of the Enterprise looks at this man and says, "What is money? What is a bank? What is a stockbroker? We don't have any of these in the 23rd century." And then they say, "If you want something, you simply ask for it and you get it." Now, that's subversive. That's revolutionary. Because if all utopian societies vanish because of scarcity and conflict, what happens when there is no scarcity? What happens when you simply ask and you get what you want? This has enormous philosophical implications. For example, why bother to work? Why bother to go to work when you simply ask for things and it comes to you? Now, some sociologists think that if drugs, for example, are totally legalized, absolutely legalized, then maybe 3 to 5% of the human race will become permanent drug addicts. That's the price for total legalization of drugs. I don't know, but that's a number that people talk about. What happens when we have this society based on replicators? Then will we have 3 to 5% of the human race become permanent parasites? This is a possibility. The whole nature of the human psyche is based around producing things, doing something, making a contribution. What happens when you don't have to do that anymore? What happens when there's infinite plenty? What happens if there is a utopia? The detractors will say, "Bah, humbug. There is no replicator. It violates the laws of physics." Well, actually, that's not true. There actually is a nanobot that can replicate, actually take apart molecules and rearrange them in fantastic ways. Mother Nature has already created it. It's called the ribosome. The ribosome can take hamburgers, milkshakes, and turn them into a baby in 9 months. That is a miracle. The ribosome takes hamburgers, French fries, potato chips, breaks apart the molecules, and reassembles them into DNA. Mother Nature has created the replicator. It replicates humans. But what happens when humans create replicators by which we can replicate everything?
An awfully small one.
I believe it's a molecular synthesizer of some kind, similar to a protein resequencer, but far more advanced. To water, cold. I saw a similar device in a Tarkalian vessel. It was capable of replicating almost any inanimate object.
If we had one of these in engineering, we could make all the spare parts we need. I wonder what else is on the menu. One pan-fried catfish. Smells like the real thing.
Well? Not bad. I doubt there's a catfish within 130 light years.
Its genome is stored in Enterprise's computer, as is the recipe. The station evidently scanned our database.
It would have been nice to have been asked. I can only imagine what else this thing knows about us.
Captain, you gotta try this.
Thanks, but I'll stick with whatever chef's serving. I'll be on the bridge.
People have this idea that computers, robots, somehow have to be cold and impersonal and uncaring. I don't see why that's true. I believe we can build artificial minds that are more caring, more compassionate, have better and more stable goal systems than any human being.
Once machines can think better than us, all these other technologies will develop faster and faster. Instead of humans developing micro-machines, nano-machines, brain scanners, artificial organisms, superhuman minds will be doing this science. At that point, human beings are no longer in control. It's a scary thought, but it's also an exciting one. One thing is for certain, it's not going to be boring.
Back in, I think, 1993, I wrote an essay called On Becoming Posthuman, and I wrote that for Free Inquiry magazine, which is probably the premier humanist publication in the United States, the invitation of the editor. And that was a very interesting experience because he told me the response, first of all, it was a huge response. He got more letters responding to it than he had in any previous article. And he said they're pretty evenly divided, 50-50, but half of them said, this is really fascinating. I'd like to know more about this. It sounds like a good idea. And the other half thought this is a terrible idea because it was challenging humanism. It was challenging the idea that we should just be, you know, the best humans we can be, because we're saying we can become something more than human. So those people sort of clung on to the current idea of the human, whereas I think the other half understood that we're really building on humanism. So I see transhumanism as a direct descendant of that, of the Enlightenment humanist project, of challenging every orthodox belief, challenging everything that we currently accept, and saying, why can't we do better? Why can't we improve human biology? Why can't we change our genome? Just because it's the way it is doesn't mean it's as good as it can be. Why do we age and die? Why can't we do something about that? People tend to make an apparently clear distinction between treating a disease or a dysfunction, therefore getting a cochlear implant or a new heart valve, on the one hand, and enhancement on the other. And a true enhancement would mean essentially becoming something better than you are, or higher functioning, perhaps better than any human being is. But that distinction is really pretty blurry the more you look at it. However, I think what we'll see is that as these become available and tested and safe, that people will very quickly forget their objections. It'll be very much like, say, open heart surgery. When that was first introduced, most people, you know, wouldn't realize this now, but most people were horrified by the idea. I mean, not really surprisingly, if you think about it, we're talking about cutting your chest open and sticking your hands in there and moving things around and sewing things up. That actually is a fairly gruesome idea. But now we think, oh, okay, if I have to have it done, you know, not looking forward to it, but everybody does it. I think if we have life extension technologies, if we have cognitive upgrades, people will very quickly realize the benefits and advantages of those. It's certainly true that we've always extended ourselves physically and cognitively. We've used external calculating devices like the abacus, you know, for a long time. We've used various kinds of artificial teeth, actually, for many centuries. So yeah, and stones, obviously, to increase our ability to cut and to stab and to build things. So yes, we've extended the body and the mind for many, many years. I don't really call that transhuman. I tend to reserve that term for something that really makes a fundamental change in the human condition. And by the human condition, if that's not to be arbitrary, I think it has to mean defined by our genes, because that's what separates us from other species. So if our genes then lead to a certain kind of brain development, a certain ability in the range of visual acuity, of auditory perception, which are limited by the way our genes have built us, then when we start talking about directly altering those genes to give us abilities beyond that, or implanting devices, or doing some of the re-engineering of the human body or brain that allows us to have, you know, perceptual and cognitive and emotional ranges beyond that of any human being, then we can talk about transhuman. So wearing eye contact lenses doesn't really make you transhuman, but it's all part of the same process of augmenting ourselves. It seemed to me many people may not have a clear idea of what transhumanism is. They'd heard many talks about various particular aspects, certain technologies, whether it's robotics or AI or biotechnology, but they may be wondering, well, how does this all fit together? What exactly is transhumanism? But really, the core of transhumanism is the idea of using reason, science, and technology backed by goodwill to overcome fundamental human limits, to live longer than we've ever lived, to become smarter, to become emotionally better than we've ever been. That is the core of it. All the other things are details. The particular technologies are not the essence of it. Maybe we'll use nanotechnology, maybe we'll use some other method, maybe we'll use biotechnology. So it's good to have arguments about which technology is most effective and most promising, but that's not the core of what defines transhumanism. There are a certain number of objections that come up frequently, especially when we talk about life extension. There are typical ones about what about overpopulation, what about resources, won't I become bored, won't dictators stay on for millions of years ruling their countries. Other people complain that it's somehow unnatural, even though human nature has always been about modifying ourselves and changing ourselves. So certain standard objections come up, and to me they're all based on a combination of fear and lack of imagination. Essentially, what people usually do when they think about these distant scenarios, they tend to project how we are today into the future. So, for one thing, you talk about life extension, bizarrely, they automatically think that we're talking about living older and getting older and older and more decrepit, and of course you would want to live like that. But we're not talking about that, we're talking about living youthfully and vigorously, in fact, better than we've ever been. Or they project other things remaining the same, not having any different technology, no better means of dealing with the environment. But the fact is that we've had environmental crises throughout human history. Back in the early Industrial Revolution, the British were burning all the forests for wood. But does that mean there are no trees left on the planet now? No, because we go through cycles. We learn new technologies, new ways of producing energy, and the same way we will respond to those challenges. So I think what transhumanists are pretty good at is thinking along multiple tracks. They can think about multiple changes at a time, not just one single change. That's not the way the world works. So almost all these objections are based on this false idea that one thing will change and nothing else will. Well, they just can't imagine other possibilities. They can't imagine new technologies changing the rules as they have always done and will continue to do so. One of the most attractive things about transhumanism, I think, is it's a very thoroughgoing philosophy of improvement. It's about self-improvement, it's about improving society, about improving the economy, about improving all our possibilities. So it's fundamentally a very progressive philosophy. It's very popular, especially among young people, to make a big deal of being an anti-racist and anti-sexist. Transhumanists find that a little bit of a yawner because, of course, that's very obvious. If we're talking about making radical alterations to ourselves, then differences in skin color and gender seem pretty trivial by comparison. So it's attractive because it really overcomes those rather artificial distinctions and looks well beyond them to what can we individually and as a species do to vastly improve our condition. So that has to be attractive. It's bringing back a vision into society that's been lacking for some time. I think we've become so focused on short-term problems and complaining about how things are that we've lost a lot of that vision. In the Enlightenment, that was the thing. They came out of the Dark Ages when nothing much good had happened for 1,000 years. And so it was a very exciting view that, with scientific method, we can actually improve life. If you're at the mercy of nature, if you're stuck in one particular environment, you can't meet anybody else. You become very insular in your tribe, and everybody else is seen as an enemy. You become very narrow in your thinking. The long run of technological progress and of economic development means that we can afford to be generous. We can afford to treat people outside our immediate tribe as part of the same community. The level of violence has declined, as a number of recent books have been arguing. If you look at the actual trends, violence has massively declined over the last few centuries as we become wealthier and smarter and more civilized. So yes, somehow it's always the very latest technology that's dehumanizing. So I think, in another 50 years, people will look at genetic engineering and, oh no, that's fine, but there'll be some other technology that's dehumanizing. So it's really a matter of the unfamiliarity combined with the unfortunate tendency of science fiction, especially in movies, to always portray dystopias, these dehumanized futures, just because that's lazy and easy to portray. It's much harder to portray a future where technology has mostly beneficial effects. It's much easier to show producing these robotic cyborgs that will go around trying to kill the rest of humanity. So unfortunately, that feeds that kind of view of dehumanization of technology.
Worf, Klingon species, a warrior race. You two will be assimilated.
The Klingon Empire will never yield.
Why do you resist? We only wish to raise quality of life for all species.
I like my species the way it is.
A narrow vision. You will become one with the Borg. You will all become one with the Borg.
I read some interviews between the Dalai Lama and a number of scientists, and some of them asked him about artificial intelligence and consciousness. Can machines ever truly think? Can they truly feel and understand? Can they be self-aware? But he said in a sort of tongue-in-cheek way that perhaps one day when programmers die, though, they will be reincarnated in artificial intelligence programs.
In the future, everything will become intelligent. Nanobots will infuse all the matter around us with information. Rocks, trees, everything will become these intelligent computers. So at that point, we can expand out into the rest of the universe. We will be sending basically nanotechnology infused with artificial intelligence. Swarms of those will go out into the universe and basically find other matter and energy that we can then harness to expand the overall intelligence of our human-machine civilization. So the universe will wake up. It'll become intelligent. And that will multiply our intelligence trillions of trillions fold. You know, we can't really fully contemplate. And that's really the main reason this is called the singularity. But regardless of what you call it, it will be the universe waking up. So does God exist? Well, I would say not yet.
Most men become more tolerant with more broad-mindedness. If we create an artificially intelligent being, able to think like a human, and connected to all human knowledge through the internet, one might conclude this being to be extremely broad-minded, and thus very tolerant to humans and life in general. We should not fear the machines, we should merge with them.
You will become one with the Borg. You will all become one with the Borg.
We can't fight them.
I gotta find them.
We need to transcend them.
This is technology. These are our transistors and diodes. CPU. Reduced instruction set computer. How can one hot dog be so hot? Sing with me. Please interpret me. Who is your Schmidt trigger? Is it her? Is it me? Serve me tea.
We are on it, Red. Side bus, to be precise, what is the size of your memory? Is it many gigabytes? 2, 3, maybe 4. Oh, it has to be certainly T.
How many revolutions per minute does your CPU fan have? Mine has 2,200 revolutions per minute. My 5 volts are correct to 1%. Are your 12 volts the same, or are they maybe only 5%? Monostable multivibrator is fundamental for love for electronics. Electrons can heat up sausage in just 5 seconds. Remember to use the 230 volts. Can't you see? Serve me tea.
science is a computer. Are you my computer? Can you compute? What is the sum of 10 and 11 binary? I want the answer in decimal numbers. Oh, you only understand hexadecimal. That is all right. You are me. Serve me tea.
Serve me tea.